Respected Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi Ji, respected Venkatesh Naik Ji, Indian Lawyers Congress State President, respected Asaf Ali, KPCC Treasurer, respected Advocate Johnson Abraham, respected DCC President Advocate Bindu Krishna, and other dignitaries on and off the dais, respected gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, Indian Lawyers Congress has launched an year-long campaign, Save Constitution, against the dictatorial reign of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi and his party BJP. And in connection with the same, we have launched so many campaign, right from the court center to the state level, which with the active participation of the members of our legal fraternity. For the convenience of the organization work, as per the decision of the state committee of the Indian Lawyers Congress, this meet is the South Zone meet. The South Zone members, the district members are right from Trivandrum to Kottayam, Trivandrum, Trivandrum, Kollam, Alappi, Pathanamthitta and Kottayam. I would like to submit that in the due months or in the due course of time, we are in the preparation for the other two zone meet, that is Northern Zone as well as the Central Zone. Within one or two, I mean within the period of April of this year, the State Committee has decided to complete all the zonal meeting and then ending into the state meet. It is with a great pleasure and vanity of sincerity, we the members of ILC welcome the chief guest, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, Mr. Singhvi ji needs no introduction. To the members of the Indian Lions Congress, our association with Singhvi ji starts right from 2011. All of you are aware, earlier our organization was Legal Cell, that was transformed to ILC, Indian Lawyers Congress. During that historic speech and inspired members of ILC at Kochi, I am very proud to be a delegate in that conference. Singhvi ji, with his sharp intellect, disarming smile and eloquent speech, had conquered the minds of the delegates attended the meet, and he lives in the minds of each and every members of the ILC. Our chief guest, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, is a legal wizard, a reputed jurist, an eminent parliamentarian, and a great statesman. It is my rare privilege to welcome him to this historic moment. On behalf of ILC State Committee and also on my personal behalf, I extend welcome to Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi.
Abhishek Manu Singhvi is being received by Jayachandran.
Mr. Vengadesh Naik
is a well-known RTA activist and a legal educator.
Advocate Assam Sharif.
He is very instrumental functionary of Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative, CHRI, a global organization working in the field of RTI, human rights and police reforms. CHRI had very closely associated with ILC in our joint efforts to work to this auspicious function. Our beloved state president of ILC, our dynamic state president of the ILC, Mr. Asaf Ali, I am having the opportunity to join with him in his first tenure as a secretary in the state committee. Still now we are cooperating each other for this function. I proudly welcome him to this auspicious function.
Advocate Senai.
Then my dear friend, Advocate Johnson Abraham. He was 1 year senior to me in the law college. We are having much relation during that time also as members of the KSU.
Is being received by Advocate.
He is now the treasurer of our KPCC and in charge of our organization. I welcome you, sir, to this auspicious function. Then our DCC president, the only one DCC president in Kerala, lady DCC president in Kerala. And we two are jointly worked in the same office. I am proud of that. Our senior, I am remembering our senior T.G. Vishwanathan at this moment. She is industrious and hardworking president of the district Congress committee, and I welcome her to this auspicious function. The remaining are the office bearers of our reputed organization ILC, the state president, vice president Raju Joseph. Before that, I welcoming Advocate Pradavarma Tambat, Meela Ibrahim, former executive committee member and ACC member, Office Advocate Raju Joseph, Dr. Raju Joseph, Advocate Vanjiur P. Parameswaran Nair, Advocate Joey George, Advocate V.C. Sabu, Advocate P. Rahim, Advocate C. Rashid, Advocate K.R. Sunil, Advocate Thangachan Matai Matthew, Advocate Sudhish Kumar, and Advocate Philip Joseph Puttanchira, and my fellow presence of the ILC district committee and advocate Sudarshan Kumar, advocate Rajiv Charachira, advocate Abraham Matthew, advocate Isho and other state executive members. And advocate Shivadevan, advocate Dheeraj Ravi, the president of the Bar Association Kollam, and other and advocate Chandi Umman, then the Bar Association president advocate Dheeraj Ravi Kollam, and I am taking this opportunity to welcome advocate M.A. Salam. He was the former immediate past president of ILC Kollam, and in this function our chief guest Manu Abhishek Singhvi will honor him after the conclusion of the program. I welcome all of you to this function. I express my sincere gratitude and thanks to the media person. I wholeheartedly welcome all brother journalists to this program. Obviously, it is a challenge for us to convey the meeting in ropes. But the thing went beyond our expectation. All cooperated with us for obeying the dress code, and I welcome all of you to this function. Thank you.
The most dynamic leader from Tharishiri, when Advocate S.F. Ali was the Director General of Prosecution, he had conducted a year-long program regarding the 150th anniversary celebrations of Indian Penal Code. The President and many eminent personalities participated in it, including Ram Jethmalani. Advocate S.F. Ali has done a lot to enhance the quality of the prosecution wing of the state and the public prosecutors too. I welcome him for the presidential address.
Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi ji, MP. Mr. Vengadesh Naik, Ms. Bindu Krishna, advocate, President DCC, Mr. Johnson Abraham, Mr. Raju Joseph, Senior Counsel, Manjur Parameswaran Nair, former SG, Joy George, VC Sabu, Rahim, K.R. Sunil, Rashid, Tangachan Matthew, Sudish Kumar, my friend Mr. Pradha Varma Thamban, and other eminent friends on the dais, dear friends. It is really a unique opportunity to me to preside over this historic meet. The very presence of Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi ji and Ms. Vengadesh Naik has order, vigor and color to this great function. Indian Lawyers Congress, which is a prime organization of the lawyers in the state, we have launched a program under the caption Save Constitution. Ever since the assumption of Modi government in Delhi, when they started certain things which threat to the constitution and our democratic system, the lawyers, be the members of the legal fraternity, has got very big role to play to save constitution. The role played by Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi ji to save democracy in Karnataka is the best example for it. It was Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi ji, I would say it is a mythic coup, constitutional coup and knocked at the door of Supreme Court at midnight and got things set it right in Karnataka, Mr. Yediyurappa had to step down. It shows the activism of lawyers. Judicial activism is based on the activism of lawyers. If there is no activism of lawyers, there can have no judicial activism. Fallius Therimani's history book, he would say that at the earliest stages of constitution, the role of court was just like an umpire in a cricket ground. After 1973, when the constitutional court, the apex court, ruled that the parliament has no unlimited power to make law or to amend constitution, the role of court has totally changed. From the umpire in the cricket ground has turned into a referee in the football ground. Wherever the player goes wrong, it is by court to whistle and correct and impose penalty. That is the things happen in Karnataka. That is why I would say, dear friends, the constitution is not the document of lawyers. It is a way of life. It is the wheel of chariot, the great Bharat. The wheel goes, the chariot will not move. So anybody touches the constitution to break the wheels, it is the duty of the members of the lawyers community to save the constitution and to save the nation. That is why we have organized this program to propagate, educate, and make the people, instigate them to come forward to act judicially. The role played by Dr. Abhishek Manmu Singhvi ji, he is razor-edged tongue in the court hall and his pen is mightier than sword. 3 hours in the mediate argument in the Supreme Court in Karnataka case proved, and he is in the grip of totalitarian regime. Just you see, even during the period of emergency, when the government went wrong, it was by court to save the constitution. A case where Mrs. Gandhi filed an election petition and the amendment was enacted with 3/4 majority in Lok Sabha. Emergency courts were silenced. No. Those days, the judiciary was very aggressive. It would indicate that when there is a force to overthrow democratic system, there is a very strong alternative force sitting on the other side. 59, there was a presidential notification imposing restriction on Article 21 and 19, and Part 3 was suspended. There was a censorship imposed. There was no free press during those days. But it was with the due process of law. Under Article 359, there was a restriction imposed by presidential order, which was set aside by majority of the court. Ultimately, in ADM Jabalpur case, it was reversed. Those judgments were set aside, and court said the Article 315 in order was valid. Now the Supreme Court overruled the ADM case, which would say that you cannot touch the 359 for restricting the powers. The law laid out by the Supreme Court in ADM Jabalpur case is not correct. But unfortunately, what is happening in Kashmir? There is no free press. Our movements are restricted. We cannot conduct a meeting. We cannot even use internet. That is what I would say, there is an undeclared emergency in this country. Yesterday, Supreme Court said, this is very dangerous signal. If the present situation allowed to continue, it will be nothing short of a death knell of democracy, we would say. So, dear friends, our responsibility is very, very greater, very, very heavy, because we cannot simply keep kept idle and would say that we are only an ordinary congressman. I requested Mr. Singhvi ji, we want to hear more law than politics. Politician as well as a lawyer, He had a great tradition as a constitutional expert. He had addressed many, many meetings in all over world. I still remember he made a speech in the 2010 ILC meeting. That was a speech made by him in the New York Bar Association speech. I still remember we really enjoyed his speech. Now this is a time for a freedom struggle. The gubernatorial heads of governments, the governors, what is the role? The Modi has made them as a managers or power brokers of the who's trading to engineer defection in the state legislative assemblies. If there is a majority against BJP, the governor will act as a power broker of a horse trading. That is what is happening. Here in Kerala, the governor started propagating a legislation. Last day in Kannur, the governor of state, he prepared a speech. He did not deliver that speech. He started delivering a speech of an ordinary politician would say that a law has been made by parliament. It is my duty to protect the constitution. See, my dear friends, 99th Constitution Amendment Act, which was enacted by parliament, supported by Congress, supported by all opposition parties. What was the fate? The majority of the state legislature ratified that National Judicial Appointment Commission. Within no time, Supreme Court struck down is unconstitutional. And the first time in history, if my memory is correct, the Supreme Court went on to the extent of reviving the old provision in the Constitution instead upholding the striking down the constitutional provision in the 19th Amendment Act. Supreme Court struck down as ultra virus, unconstitutional, illegal, void ab initio, and revived. In a discussion, I would say that, Governor, how can you say that the majority is not the touchstone? If the majority is the touchstone, what was the fate of 42nd Amendment Act? Section 15.5 of the 42nd Amendment was struck down by Supreme Court. Citizenship Amendment Act is passed by majority. During the period of emergency, Congress Party had even after emergency, Congress Party had 353 members in parliament. The opposition Janata Party had only 31. During those days, Supreme Court in the Minerva Bill case struck down the provisions of 42nd Amendment. It indicates what? India stands on the pedestal of judicial foundation. We, the members of legal fraternity, have got very great role to play. When the executive goes wrong, it is by the legislature, it is not by the legislature, it is not by the political party, it is by the members of the legal fraternity. Take for example, history speaks volumes on the role played by members of the legal fraternity. The great American Revolution, most of the members were lawyers. John Adams was a lawyer. George Washington was a lawyer. Thomas Jefferson was a lawyer. In American Civil War, Abraham Lincoln was a lawyer. Martin Luther King Jr. was a lawyer. Even in the Russian Revolution, great Lenin, V.A. Lenin, was also a non-practicing lawyer. In the 3/4 of the members of the French Revolutionary Council, majority of them were lawyers. Dabespere, Dante, they were all lawyers. Take for example Indian freedom struggle. W.C. Banerjee, Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, Motilal Nehru, all were lawyers. Every moment the lawyers alone can stand on the front. If you are organizing a mammoth rally, if you are filing a public interest litigation, the result of the public interest litigation would be very, very productive and effective than a mammoth rally. That is why I would say, dear friends, we the members of the ILC have got very role to play. When the government goes wrong, in the first year, Atal Bihari Vajpayee government, a constitutional review committee was constituted. For what? To review the constitution. Ignoring the law laid down by Supreme Court on the basis structure theory, they constituted a committee to review constitution, the result was nil. That is why I would say we have to educate. That is why I request Sri Abhishek Manu Singhviji to deliver a legal speech. You educate us. Just imagine, my friend, an ordinary man told me, Mr. Asaf Ali, if a patient is in the coma, in the midnight hours, he was knocking the door of a medical shop, he would say, I will not open. You come tomorrow. Even if the patient dies, this is the vision dawned on his head to knock the door of Supreme Court during midnight to save democracy, to save constitutional hijack by Modi. They had to succumb to the defeat. They have to surrender the fact the constitution is supreme. That is what I would say, we repeat, we the people. That is why this program has been organized by 5 districts. We have selected members, Mr. Sajee Babu and Subhadev, and 5 district presidents have been making very sincere efforts to picking choose and cream members. These are only the cross section of the cream. This day is very, very important. This day is a beginning of a great event, a fight against the constitutional hijack by Modi and Shah government in Delhi. I would say we have to educate people. Even if there is a majoritarianism, it will not win. Just imagine the Modi tomorrow brings an amendment to the constitution. The tenure of parliament is 25 years. Naturally, it will be enacted. Naturally, our president will sign. Naturally, the notification will issue. Is it a law? Can the Modi and Shah extend the tenure of parliament is 25 years? No, because there is an invisible basis structure theory in the constitution. It is by the members of the legal fraternity, especially ILC, enlighten the people. Even if there is majority, they cannot. Even if they got central government, they cannot. People are great. The basic structure, you cannot touch the basic structure. But we have to educate people. We have to educate congressmen. Then only we can fight, we can wage a war against the constitutional and the constitutional coup. That is why I request, my dear friends, you make use of, we are very anxiously expecting a very volatile, very educative, very legal-oriented political speech. Mr. Manu Singhvi is a rare person because in Rajya Sabha, he is shining well. In Supreme Court, he is shining well. That is what I would say. His very great presence has added order and color to this great function. Dear friends, we make use of this great function, a great success, and make use of each and every minute of this session to fight against the totalitarian rule. I wish all of you a very great grand success to this function. Thank you.
The chairman of the meeting, Sri Sajee Babu, member of Kerala Bar Council and general convener, our state president, Sri T. Asaf Ali, our guest of honor, Sri Abhishek Manu Singhi, Sri Johnson Abraham, Treasurer KPCC, Bindu Krishna, President DCC, our Raju Joseph, Senior Advocate and Vice President ILC, Sri Vajiyur Prabhasharan, former ASG, Vice President ILC, Sri Joy George, Advocate, General Secretary ILC, VC Sabu, General Secretary ILC, Sri P. Rahim, former Acting President ILC, Sri Rashid, Vice President ILC, Sri K.R. Sunil, General Secretary ILC, Sri Thangachan Matthew, General Secretary ILC, Sri Sudhish Kumar, Treasurer ILC, Sri Chandi Umman, Senior Advocate Sri Salam Sir, Vengadesh Nayak, Pradav Parvatabban, and Sri Sudarshan Kumar, Alappuzha ILC President and Bar Council Member, our Sri George Abraham Pachil, Sri Sribhar Nair Sir, Sri Rajiv K.S. Charachara, ILC Trivandrum President, and Sri Abraham Matthew, ILC Pathanamthitta, and Sri Isho, President ILC Kottayam, Sri C.B. Chennappadi, other dignitaries on the dais,
my dear colleagues, friends, brothers and sisters, the duty cast upon me to introduce our chief guest. And Dr. Abhishek Singh was born in Jodhpur, Rajasthan on 24th February 1959 in a Marwadi family to Kamala Singhvi and Rashmi Mal Singhvi. His father, Rashmi Mal Singhvi, was a scholar in Jain history and culture and a renowned royal and India's former High Commissioner to the UK. Abhishek Singhvi is married to Gesalad Sufi Singh and Anita Singhvi. They have two sons, Anubhav and Abhishkar. Friends, he completed his school from St. Columbus School and he obtained B.A. Honours and M.A. Ph.D. Phil, educated at St. Columbus School, Delhi, and St. Stephen's College, Delhi University, and Trinity College, University of Cambridge, UK, and Harvard University. He topped India at the School Leaving India School Certificate exam and did B.A. Economics Honours in St. Stephen's College and M.A. and Ph.D. from Trinity College. Cambridge, UK, he also taught St. John's College, Cambridge, and did a summer program, Phil from Harvard University. He has lectured student, faculty groups, and general audiences at Stanford, Harvard, Yale, Boston, MIT, and George Washington Universities to NGOs and think tanks like Heritage Foundation, International Council of World Affairs of Washington, D.C., Washington, D.C., USA, and addressed several international conferences, including those at Paris and Pakistan. Abhishek Banu Singhvi was conferred honorary Doctor of Laws degree from Amity, Rajasthan and Jain Vishwabharati Universities. Abhishek Banu Singhvi is visiting Timbal lecturer at Yale University, USA in 2011. Constitution law, administrative law, corporate law, commercial law, and international commercial arbitrage are his special areas of professional interest. Abhishek Banu Singhvi has been a matter member of Supreme Court, created and administered bilateral legal firms, including the Indo-British, Indo-US, and Indo-Canadian, and Indo-Israel OIS. Dr. Abhishek Singhvi is an eminent jurist, parliamentarian, and visible media personality, well known of all India author and commentator. National spokesman of Congress, former chairman of Parliamentary Committee on Law, eminent jurist, former additional Solicitor General of India, former chairman of AICC Law and Human Rights Department. He is a writer, speaker, thinker, and well-known media personality. He is a member of parliament, the senior most national spokesperson of the Congress Party, the youngest designated senior advocate, Supreme Court of India at the age of 34. And the former and the youngest additional Solicitor General of India at the age of 37. And former elected Vice President of Supreme Court Bar Association. Manu Singhvi is currently Chairman of AICC All India Law and Human Rights Department and Chairman of Parliamentary Committee on Law Justice Personal Grievances. He was formerly Vice Chairman of Congress Media Department. Friends, Abhishek Manu Singhvi is an eminent personality in the Indian political scenario. He belongs to the International Congress. He is also a member of the Parliament of India, representing Rajasthan in Rajya Sabha. Having acknowledged by the Global Leader of Tomorrow Award in 1999, he has been an actively inspiring role model for the youngsters. In 2007, Abhishek Manu Singhvi was invited to hold lectures on federalism, which was printed and prominent and esteemed by in IAPA journal, apart from the best essay. Abhishek Manu Singhvi's association with the media has been noted since a long time with the help of his expression force communication through the amazing and humorous self-possessed non-emotional conversational tags. His contribution in media includes Candid Corner, a column written by him in a Hindustan Times, which was also published in a book form. Dr. Abhishek Singhvi reflects his stature by being an attractive source to a dynamic and ever-populated feeling of privileged and influential class in the society. Apart from these various contributions as a politician, an important one is that support of Lokpal Bill. He says, "You are creating breeding ground for corruption. You are making a body outside the whole system with inherent conflict of interest. Our conception is of interest. Our conception is of a checks and balances. Abhishek Singhji always had a time to appear in the electronic reports channels and has ensured to contribute his bit by submitting his voice to print media. His association to the media has been noted since a long time with the help of his expression for its communication through his amazing and humorous, self-possessed and non-emotional conversation talks. It was not a chance play to itinerary, type and political ladder come keen over the media discussions due to his sermon and speech with the articulator cleared about his deep thoughts and expressions about any given topic, be it current or what happened of late. Dear friends, such a wonderful personality, I am a shining star of Supreme Court, an eminent parliamentarian, I introducing before this August gathering. Thank you.
Thank you. As a juggler of many things, Singhvi is both effective and efficient, the ultimate multitasker.
The most dynamic and powerfully voiced president of this important association, Mr. Asaf Ali, esteemed and eminent members on the dais, including each and every office bearer, the DCC president, various other high profile office bearers and functionaries in the organization, but above all, members of my esteemed Biradari, the Biradari of Nyay and Neeti, I would say humbly, Swagatam Nyay Neeti Samuham. Listening to this very, very generous, extremely generous introduction, I was reminded about my favorite joke, which I have recited many times in Delhi, but I can take the liberty of saying it here again because this is a Kerala audience. The joke is about, well, it's not a joke, it's a true incident and describes my feelings at the moment, about a bishop who was invited to be an after-dinner speaker, just like I have been asked to be a pre-lunch speaker. And the bishop, like me, was introduced in extremely glowing terms, extremely glowing, felicitous prose, as you have just heard our friend introducing me. So when it came to the turn of the speaker, the bishop, to speak, as it is now my turn to speak, he began, and I likewise begin, by seeking two forgivenesses. First forgiveness I seek is for Asaf Ali and the person who introduced me, because they have clearly exceeded the bounds of truth. So they must be forgiven for having exceeded the bounds of truth. The second one I seek for myself, for having enjoyed it so much. Well, friends, this gathering brings back happy memories of many associations and events especially two. One, the year I was reminded, I had forgotten, was 2009, I think, in Kochi. Kochi, where I attended. And many of you, or some of you must have been there, I recognize some faces here who were there. And it brought together the clear synergy, the clear umbilical cord between the law persons, be it judges, lawyers, teachers, law associate people. 2011 was one of the biggest, and even if I say it myself, one of the most amazing gatherings of lawyers we had in Vigyan Bhavan. Every corner was filled. Many of you were here. Of course, Asaf Ali was there, but some of you here were there. Standing space was not available, and for a full day, while in power, we had each and every person from the Prime Minister of India, every cabinet minister of note, every department, every general secretary, every PCC president, from roughly 9:30 to 5 o'clock in a freewheeling open discussion. That is the strength of lawyers. It is sometimes forgotten by us because we underestimate ourselves. We neither realize our potential nor our power. Yes, we should all be humble individually, but collectively, the power of the legal community far outstrips any other single community. One lawyer in one district influences at least 100 opinion makers. You don't realize it. You are, in a very real sense, the thinkers, the movers, the shakers, because your power and influence extends beyond yourself. Your talent and training is to first listen to people. Doctors are also important, architects are also important, engineers are also important. All professionals are important. But there is hardly any profession which interfaces with real life, real people, and real problems every day. When somebody has slapped someone, when somebody has cheated someone, when somebody has murdered someone, when some spouse is behaving cruelly to another spouse, these are everyday human problems. And you are first listening, second absorbing understanding, third disgorging after analysis, and fourth persuading a third party judge. This is a very remarkable function which perhaps no other professional class can do, and that is why, with the greatest of respect to every other professional class, the interface, that's why people ask me, why are lawyers the most in public life? By the way, I don't like the word politics. So insulted and so distorted a word that it is better to use the word public life. But one of the reasons why lawyers or law persons are most closely connected with public life is this. Because they are, a doctor does his own work, but he doesn't interface with the public in the same sense. The architect also does not, the engineer also does not, but a lawyer does. And that is where your power and your potential, which each one of you underestimates, comes. So if you decide, each one of you, to influence 100 influence makers around you, each of those 100 will influence a further 10 around them. And you then see the multiplier effect of this profession and this community. Of course, I think that this cuts across lawyers of any ideology and any persuasion or affiliation. But since this is mainly a Congress-oriented lawyers group, I must also remind you the very singular and unprecedented role which lawyers have played in this party alone, in the INC. Most people forget that the first president of the Congress was a lawyer, W.C. Banerjee. Most people forget the grand names we've had, at the origin in the early nascent stages where it was being built up against the British, the Gokhales, the Tayyabjis, and then India's most famous NRI. The NRI was a barrister first, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. And he fashioned his tools, even on that platform in South Africa, on the basis of his training as a lawyer, which he then exported and imported into India as the most powerful Brahmastra of Ahimsa. Motilal Nehru's filings, tax filings in the 20s and 30s, when he was practicing in the Privy Council, he was earning a fabulous sum. His per appearance fee for the Privy Council was fabulous. He was the most successful and moneyed lawyer in India. He gave up a lot of it to join the freedom struggle under Gandhiji's inspiration. But these were all law persons. And that is why I start with this little reminder to something about something which we all know about, but the obvious frequently requires to be reiterated. Now, this is mainly a legal meet, and as instructed by your president, I will mostly speak like a lawyer. I don't want to sound rhetorical, political, general, vague. You know, people say you should be more political. Sometimes that means you should be more vague, you should be more rhetorical, you should only use big slogans. So I'm going to speak about hardcore facts, law, doctrines, because you are an enlightened community of practitioners from, I'm told, 5 districts. But before that, a few preliminary points. The first preliminary point, and these preliminary points are vital as we look at some legal issues, because these preliminary points are the structure within which Save the Constitution theme arises. The first preliminary point, friends, is that unfortunately we live today in fear. I wish there were people in this gathering who are not of the Congress persuasion. I'm sure there must be some, disclosed or undisclosed. But even if there is any person who is not at all affiliated or not a committed congressman, even he will have to admit, for that matter, a BJP lawyer will have to admit, that we live in this country in fear like we have never lived before. Put your hand to your heart and ask yourself, is there not fear all around you? Judges are in fear because of vilification, transfers, punitive measures. Public life people, politicians are fear because of EDs, CBIs, ITs. Industrialists live in fear. All kind of nice photo opportunities with Mr. One doesn't change that fear. Dissenters, disagreeers, protesters live in fear. There are innumerable examples. Take one example of a constitutional authority. There can hardly be somebody more immune than a constitutional authority. There's only one example, by way of example. Between April and May, or rather end of March to May or April to May, I was the head of the challenges to the Election Commission during the national election. And we made some 40 major, at the apex level only the major ones come. 35 or 40 major accusations and challenges where campaigning had to be changed because level playing field was not observed. I led the delegation, I spoke at the Election Commission. 20 of them, we got relief. Another 10 or 12 of them, we got largely some relief or some modification, which leaves only 15 or 14. 10 of those 14 were squarely against Prime Minister Modi and Home Minister Amit Shah, the complaints. For 1.5 months out of a 2-month election campaign, the Election Commission did not even decide, because non-decision is by itself a decision. 1.5 months out of two and a half months campaign was over, it was pending. Then I went to the Supreme Court again and we got a direction, decide in 2 days. There was a 2-1 dissent in those 10. In all those 10. You know the name of the dissenter? I'm talking of fear. That's my first point. He's living in fear now. He's election commissioner. Every day you read about him. His name is Lavasa. This is the second thing. We are talking of preliminary points, general points. The second thing is that, and incidentally, of those 10, the 10 were 2-1 decisions, Lavasa dissenting with reasons. The majority gave no reasons. Simple dismissal. We asked for disclosure of files, they said files can't be disclosed. So till today we don't have the reason why. There were clear cases where Mr. Modi has talked about a community, where Mr. Shah has talked about, you know, the election model conduct, model code of conduct, you know the rules. So there were clear violations and reasons were given. But anyway, that's by the way. The second is that we have a daily diet, a hunger to find new enemies. This new regime has a daily hunger to find or to make or to invent new enemies. Pratap Bhanu Mehta wrote a very nice article recently. Of course, he's a perpetual dissenter. He used to abuse Congress, he used to abuse other parties, but he's written a very nice piece. He says that you must find a new enemy every day to keep the pot boiling. It is like that old saying, an apple a day keeps the doctor away, an enemy a day keeps your health good. So, the moment you deal with one enemy, you find another one. That is the job of this government. Enemies are all and sundry. Jholawalas, liberals like your next session speaker, I don't know why he is still not under sufficient pressure. Students, urban naxals, tukde tukde gang, intellectuals, Khan market people, protesters, dissenters, Lutyens elite. I have got so many phrases I never had. I never learned these phrases. I've learned them in the last 5 years. All of these are new enemies of the state. The state is defined as new enemies of 1.5 persons. And therefore you remember those great evocative phrases that in a democracy, dissent is an act of faith, is what William Fulbright said. We've all forgotten that. This regime has forgotten it. We must not confuse dissent with disloyalty. We have all forgotten this. The third, therefore, is dissent has never been such a casualty in a democracy, in Indian democracy, as now. Everyone who dissents or disagrees is anti-national. A cartoon is seditious. Straight sedition. A writing is anti-national. I don't know how many of you have read Fez. I know you're not Hindi speaker. I was very pleasantly amused to find that 33% of Malayali is Sanskrit. On the way traveling here, I was checking up the words. That's why I was able to say Swagatam, Niti Nyay, Samuham, all Sanskrit, which is Hindi also. Well, Faiz wrote this famous poetry, Hum Dekhenge. It is one of the most classic poems for the last, whatever, 20, 40 years. I have read it, very powerful poetry, and you must go and see it on your internet again. Extremely powerful. Faiz was a person who opposed Pakistan regime all his life. He did go to Pakistan, but he was exiled, he lived in England. He thoroughly opposed, he wrote something which would be 100 times seditious by today's standards. He was an iconoclast, anti-establishment. A professor in IIT, it has never happened, I can't believe it, just 2 weeks ago, a professor in IIT raised the question, an assistant professor in IIT, the temple of science and technology. That's why we are living in a different climate. This is New India. This is the New India. Which New India the Prime Minister talks about, I don't know. This is certainly a New India. He raised an inquiry that two lines of fares, which are recited by everybody in India for the last 50 years, should be subject of an inquiry. Because he was talking of butparasti in Islam, which is pure symbolism and imagery. It was not about religion at all. Anybody who knows fares, anybody who knows fares' history knows it had nothing to do with religion. So, first astonishment was that somebody could today in 2019, 3 or 4 weeks ago, ask for this inquiry. Sorry, just at the end of last year. Second was more astonishing. The inquiry was not ordered against this assistant professor, but against Faiz's two lines by the IIT. You would have read in the Indian Express the article. That professor, by the way, has got some very radical fundamentalist views about how there should be a state religion in India. But the inquiry was ordered at his request against those two lines of Faiz by the institution where he teaches. I could not think of this India a few years ago. Of course, the best example of this New India, best or worst, depends on which one you look at it, is JNU. You are a little away, 2,000 kilometers away from JNU. I live about 3 kilometers away from JNU. The funniest part is that today is 11th. This happened on Sunday, which I believe was 5th or 4th. 5th. Till today, the police is not able to give you any finding about Sunday. A false equivalence is created trying to say that you also did it, I also did it, so both are equally responsible. Preliminary inquiries are leaked about Thursday and Wednesday, report has come today, not about the Sunday incident. Even a blind man knows what happened in JNU. But the police of Delhi doesn't know. They will all lose their jobs if they speak the truth. The lady with the mask has been named. Her name is Komal Sharma of the ABBP. You must have seen on your social media that lady with the mask. Everybody must have seen. The person who was named as the left gang leader has been found to be an ABBP official. We are now talking not of Kollam, we are talking of the heart of the capital of India, where at 3:30, the president of the union sends a message, 3:30 p.m., to the police saying, there are people massing around here, please send reinforcements. Police comes at 7 o'clock and the vice chancellor writes to say, please stand at the gate, the moment we call you, you should come. By 8:30, everything is over, police has not come inside, they are standing at the gate. Does the government of India think that you and I all eat grass? Does the government of India think that we are innocent babes in the wood? Does the government of India think that we have no mind, no brain? And ultimately, although I had to miss it, I was to speak on it, but I had committed, so I was in the plane yesterday. The India Today sting, yesterday night when I was in the plane, shows everyone who is interviewed in that sting proudly proclaiming, yes, we did it. They're all ABBP official activists. All of them say, we planned like this. We told people to be outside but not come in. We put masks. We had blacked out the CCTVs. This has come in the sting yesterday. And the police has a press conference, which I believe it was yesterday, which gives details of the earlier incident about registration on Wednesday and Thursday, doesn't say a word about Sunday, and they say that we are still investigating the Sunday incident. Now there is a false equivalence being created. A false equivalence means, yes, I was guilty, but you also slapped me. So both of us are guilty. This is known as a false equivalence. Friends, this is the new India. Fear, dissent, new enemies. And that is why we have to hearken back to those old good words. The words of Benjamin Franklin, who said, "It is the first responsibility of every citizen to question authority." That's the first responsibility of lawyers also, by the way. But the pathshala to which number one and number two, or number one and number one and a half went, never taught Benjamin Franklin's statements. You have to remember the words of Howard Zinn: protest beyond the law is not a departure of democracy. It is absolutely essential to democracy. The American president Dwight Eisenhower said, "May we never confuse honest dissent with subversion." But these are not distinctions known to our rulers today. And John F. Kennedy, who was the peak of his popularity, more popular than any American president of that time, said, "Without debate, without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed, and no republic can survive." But in a sense, it is good, because as they say, before the Vinash Kale comes, the Buddhi has to be made Vipreet. So Vipreet Buddhi is the precursor to Vinash Kale. The fourth preliminary point is typecasting. Everything is typecasted. Typecasted means everything is classified. You are the left, they are the right. So the typecasting is, for example, again, for 72 years, 74 years, I have never even imagined that a Prime Minister of India can say this, quote unquote, not denied, on camera, "You can recognize the protesters by the clothes they are wearing." So you typecast. You typecast this person who has a beard, and this person who has a cap, and this person who doesn't have a beard. It's classification. The first time you have senior ministers, mark my word, senior office bearers, not the ordinary worker of the ruling party, the names you know for the last 5 years, the Balians, the Katyars, the Swami Chinmayanands, there are 20 names like this. They say anything they like, they say it whenever they want, and what happens after that? Then you have a wink and a nod. You have a Nelsonian blind eye. You know the story of Nelson. Nelson was fighting and he was told to attack this side. He knew that he would win if he attacked this side. So he said, "I have a blind eye this side. I will not look here. I will look only this side." Now Nelson won the war, but ultimately what is happening is that people like Katyars, Balians, Swami Chinmayanands, etc., I'm not talking of the real Swami, I'm talking of the other fellow, the one who's, they are people who are office bearers, who are ministers, who are never punished, never suspended, never removed, never even questioned. This is known as a policy of impunity with a wink and a nod. And they classify you, they typecast you by what you wear, what you eat, what you think, what you do, where you go, what you is typecasting. And the last of my preliminary points is, along with the typecasting, this is linked to it, is an exclusionary narrative, a narrative of conformism. By itself, in its own, homogeneity and uniformity has become a virtue in this country. Everything should be uniform. Everything should be homogeneous. We should all think alike. We should all speak alike. We should all wear alike. We should all eat alike. We should all speak alike. We should use the same language. So one nation, one religion, one language, one thought process. Sounds great and disciplined. The last time somebody did it was in 1933 in a country in the north of Europe. And you know that led to the Second World War. Now, they are therefore, this theory, I'm on the philosophy behind it, is actually the antithesis of the idea of India. It is a negation of the diversity of India. I've always believed that when we celebrate diversity in India, we are doing no favor to anyone. It is our own selfish self-interest, because it is necessary for our survival. India is a country where, you know, I take the analogy of the kite, patang we call it in the north. When you fly a kite, the more dheel, we say in the north, the more loose you let it be, it flies higher sometimes. The more you pull, it snaps. The more you let India go, India becomes stronger, binds. The more you constrain India, pull India, impose on India, the more it snaps, it bursts at the scene. Why? Because we are planet Earth's most diverse spot. There is no spot on planet Earth which is more diverse than India on any parameter. And you are doing no favor to anyone. You are holding this country together by allowing its diversity to flourish. And that is why you have to realize these principles. You have to realize that patriotism is too often the refuge of scoundrels. Dissent, rebellion, and all round hell raising remain the true duty of patriots. A very famous writer said this. And on coercive uniformity, Robert Jackson, a famous writer, said this: those who begin coercive elimination of dissent soon find themselves exterminating dissenters. Compulsory unification of opinion achieves only the unanimity of the graveyard. The unanimity of the graveyard, is this your object, is my question to all of you. And may I end this preliminary opening by making my last point, which is not really a preliminary point, it's a question which I ask many, many audiences abroad, and sometimes an audience in India also. It's the simplest question which I've ever come across, but it has no simple answers. I've never found a fully satisfactory answer, but let me ask the question still. The question I ask is, just ask yourself that between 1930 and 1960, roughly 30 or 40 countries emerged from the yoke of imperialism. They were all ex-colonial powers. Britain, British imperialism, Belgian imperialism, Dutch imperialism, French imperialism. And these countries were scattered across Asia, across Africa, South America. Approximately 30 to 40 countries, and you know the names, all of Africa, all of Asia, all our neighbors, each one of our neighbors, South Asia. Now the question, can you give me any reason why India is the only country out of those 30, 40 countries, only, to have remained a vibrant democracy? I can't think of a single country which is a vibrant democracy after becoming independent from Britain, from Holland, from France. Not a single country. And a country of our size, a true vibrant democracy, not one of our neighbors, not Nepal, not Pakistan, not Bangladesh, not Sri Lanka, not Afghanistan, none. But not anywhere in Africa, not anywhere in South America, not anywhere in Australasia, not the Asian tigers, which we find so great in economic performance, the Taiwans, the Singapores, the whatever. Not one of them is a vibrant democracy. South Korea's, North Korea's, Philippines. Now, I have no answer to my own question. My question, first answer is sheer good luck. That's the best answer I can give. Second answer is that we got the sequencing right. We got Gandhi before Nehru. there is no bigger, better person to get independence by non-violent means ever born on the face of this earth than Gandhi. He was the agitational politician par excellence, but agitational without violence. But equally, without Nehru, we would never have preserved that independence, because Nehru, for all his faults, and certainly he had faults, he would be divine if he did not have faults, was the most magnanimous democrat. In spirit and thinking, he was democratic. That is why India has remained a democracy. And therefore, each one of the abusers of Nehru and the guarded, camouflaged critics, mark my words, guarded, camouflaged critics of Gandhi, must remember that India is the only country which emerged from imperialism and remains a vibrant democracy, for precisely the reasons which we are now fighting. And the moment these reasons vanish, India will not remain a democracy. The fear I talked about, the conformity I talked about, the typecasting I talked about, the intolerance of dissent I talked about. And that is why Abraham Lincoln, who used the might of the state, he used illegal means to save the democracy, said, "If there is anything that links the human to the divine, it is the courage to stand by a principle when everyone else rejects it." And another US president, Herbert Humphrey, said, "Freedom is hammered out on the anvil of discussion, debate, and dissent." I wish one of our superheroes had at least read some of this. I wish one of our regime masters had understood or absorbed even a fraction of what I have said. And just to end on this preliminary part, just 2 days ago I read in the papers, which you might have missed, a Gujarat school, all-girls school in Gujarat, issued a directive to every girl student that you must write a letter saying, "I support CAA." Luckily, in the evening, some parents learnt of it. So next day they issued a letter saying, no, this was a mistake, unintended. Each and every girl, this is my example of conformity, homogeneity, unity. One India, one thought process. If your thought process is different, you are anti-national. Well, friends, lest you accuse me of beating around the bush for too long, let me come now to some hardcore legal topics. And the first of which is obviously, and it is both apposite and ironical, Asaf Ali has done it without realizing it. He has asked me to speak first on the Citizenship Amendment Act, which came into force only yesterday. So yours is perhaps the first big gathering on the CAA. It was notified yesterday. Now, let me try and make it simple. We are now coming more to law and less to public life and politics. Now, let us look at CAA, then I'll come to NRC, then I'll come to NPR. By the way, when you say look at CAA, then I'll come to NPR, then you come to NRC, it is actually a very wrong statement by me. It is like saying that look at this cake. Look at the top of it, which is chocolate. The next line, which is white, ignore it. The bottom line, which is vanilla, ignore it. It is all one composite, it's completely hyphenated. It is inextricably intertwined. It is what egg eaters, and I'm a vegetarian, call a scrambled egg. So what I've said is wrong. You can't look at CAA, not look at NRC. You can't look at NRC, not look at NPR. But I will do that for a while and then come to all three together. First, let's look at CAA on principle. Let me give you a simplest example which I find useful. Conceptually, and you're a lawyer, so you'll understand. Assume that this room here has 100 people. It has many more, fortunately, but assume it has only 100. Out of those 100, straight away 60 persons here are not from those three countries which we have decided to per se insult. The three countries are Pakistan, Bangladesh and Afghanistan. Our law says that per se, every minority in your country is persecuted. Just imagine if Afghanistan passed a law saying every Afghani in India, it's a per se insult of India. But forget that, that's by the way. So 160 of you are from countries other than Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. So that leaves how many? 40. Of the 40, 15 follow the religion of Islam and 5 are Jews. So that 40 becomes 20. Because the Muslims and the Jews incidentally who are forgotten, of course Jews is only by way of example. It doesn't apply because there's hardly any Jews in this formula. But theoretically, if out of the 40, there are 15 Muslims and 2 or 3 Jews, they are excluded. Only left is 20 who are Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs, etc., etc. Now what has happened is, all 100 of us, remember, are in one camp. You are forgetting that. You are thinking as if new people are going to come in future. No. The cutoff date is 2014 December. I hope I am clear. So you are all, these 100 of you are in one camp. You are all people of doubtful citizenship already. There are actual camps existing. You are 100 of doubtful citizenship. Now out of the 100 of doubtful citizenship, I straight away make that group into 20. It doesn't matter whether they are different figure, I am giving an example only. So 100 becomes 60, 60 becomes, 100 becomes 40, 40 becomes 20. Now these 20 who are left get what is known as a special fast track citizenship. They get a special fast track citizenship. Now this special fast track citizenship is given on what basis? One, it is deemed that every Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, etc. in those 20, it is deemed that he is persecuted. No evidence of persecution is required. No proof, no adjudication, no tribunal, no verification. I have to say, I am in this room, I am one of the 100, I came before 2014 December, I am a Hindu, I was earlier in Pakistan, I was persecuted, full stop. Number two, did you know that the word persecution is not even used in the act at all? You have not read the act. Persecution is used only in the statement of objects once. Statement of objects uses once. Act doesn't use it. Because there is no mechanism for finding out persecution. So what you are saying is, to conclude this part by a simple example, that out of a room of 100 equal people living in a detention center in Kollam, I will look at 20 only, and the 20 I will look at will get fast track citizenship on the basis of religion. Second, persecution would be a valid basis of giving citizenship. I would support the government if they did it. What is persecution? There is a refugee convention, a treaty. The refugee treaty says in a particular clause that anybody who is persecuted means you have to be found to be persecuted, not that I just say I am persecuted. My wife is hitting me, therefore I am persecuted. That is not persecution. Persecution has to be by established means of verification. So, assuming that you are persecuted, that treaty says that a country should never refuse access. No country who has signed the treaty should refuse access to a persecuted person. The treaty therefore says, it's a technical word, French word, there should be no refoulement, R-E-F-O-U-L-M-E-N-T. Refoulement means that if I come as a persecuted person, I can't be sent back. The principle of non-refoulement. Now I agree straight away, the answer of Mr. Amit Shah and Mr. Modi is that we have not signed the treaty. Of course we have not signed the treaty. So this principle doesn't apply to us as signatories of the treaty. But they don't tell you the full truth. The full truth is that the principle of this treaty has been held to be part of customary international law. And customary international law means jus cogens, J-U-S, next word is C-O-G-E-N-S. And customary international law and jus cogens means that all countries on earth are bound by it without signing the treaty. Suppose the treaty says a person with black hair should not be picked up from the road and killed on sight, and 50 countries sign it. Now country number 51 to 100 don't sign it. But this principle is so basic, so fundamental, it is like our basic structure of the constitution. So even those countries 51 to 100 who have not signed the treaty are bound by it, because the principle is so basic as to be called customary international law. Namely, a principle so fundamental that it binds non-signatories. Well, non-refoulement has been held to be part of customary international law. Many times, I'll give you one example, the 2012 judgment of the European Court of Human Rights in a case from Italy called Hirsi Jama says, I quote, "The prohibition of refoulement is a principle of customary international law, binding on all states, even those not parties to the United States Convention relating to refugees, and even those not parties to any other treaty for the protection of refugees. In addition, it is a rule of jus cogens on account of the fact that no derogation is permitted from its peremptory nature and no reservations to it are admitted," unquote. Now, what does it mean? It means that tomorrow, a Hindu from Sri Lanka, I am giving the example which hurts Mr. Modi and Mr. Shah the most. I am a Tamilian from Sri Lanka. I complain of persecution as many Tamilians have complained. He doesn't get fast track in this room of 100. You have my sympathy, you have my crocodile tears, but you don't get fast track. And here you have proved, because Tamilians have proved persecution in Sri Lanka. Even then you can't enter. Why? Because Mr. Modi says we have not signed refugee treaty, but he forgets this principle. Now why should we stop at Tamilians from Sri Lanka? Why not? Somebody did an interesting calculation. I was stunned. I was truly stunned. I hope I have the figures. Now, it is true, and this actually has a lot of relevance for Kerala. It has most relevance for Kerala. Now, I know they are not persecuted. But if you take the principle that only minorities in three Muslim countries are persecuted, then you have to realize, and I know it's an oversimplistic example, but the example applies. Did you know that there are 6.3 million Hindus in South Africa? Did you know that 1.6 million in Oman, 1.1 million in Kuwait, these are all Islamic countries, by the way, state religion is Islam, 0.9 million in Bahrain, 1.3 million in Qatar, this all has great relevance to Kerala, by the way, 9 million in UAE, 5 million in Pakistan, 5 million in Bangladesh. Now, I'm now talking of Article 14. On what basis is this classification made? And equally, of course, how is the classification made for several people who may be facing persecution in Burma, in other countries in our neighborhood? Apart from the fact that we know the kind of persecution faced by two communities in Pakistan, which we are ignoring, Ahmadiyyas and Baluchis. All of them are excluded. On which principle? Article 14. What is Article 14? The first principle of Article 14 is arbitrary selection. So, what is the arbitrariness in this? It illegally conflates religion on the one hand and persecution on the other. Only a Hindu, and only a Hindu in three countries can be persecuted. A non-Hindu can't be persecuted, and a person who is a non-Muslim or a non-Hindu in countries other than these three also can't be persecuted. Equally, all non-Muslims from these three countries are deemed to be persecuted. I'm not talking of hardcore law, Article 14, so arbitrariness. Second, discriminatory. It is obviously discriminatory because it gives a fast track to 20 people in the room of 100 in a camp in Kolam on the basis of religion. Does Article 14 say that you can make a reasonable classification on the ground of religion? Does Article 14 say that you can make a reasonable classification? Third, it does not satisfy its own objectives. I've given the examples. If your objective was to help only Hindus, there are large numbers whom you have not helped. Now, let us look a little further and we'll come to NRC and NPR. By the way, Amartya Sen, who is of course another public enemy number one as far as this government is concerned, doesn't matter that he's a Nobel Prize winner, doesn't matter that he's an Indian, doesn't matter that he was a Harvard professor, he happened to be, much after my time, the head of my college in Trinity College, Cambridge also, world-renowned chap. But he's a villain. He's a villain, a public enemy number one. Why? Because he speaks his mind. And that mind doesn't match always the government's opinion. He said just 3 days ago, he said, how can you link citizenship with religion is the first point. Second, citizenship can only have linked to two things, where you are born and where you lived. Citizenship can never have any link to religion. Persecution is an independent test, no link with religion. Citizenship is an independent test, no link with religion. The beauty of this legislation of 1.5 persons is to conflate and mix religion, persecution, and citizenship. This is a fantastic cocktail. It's a cocktail never invented, except by our rulers now. Three totally non-Article 14 tests are made into one cocktail. Citizenship, religion, and persecution. Now, according to obvious common sense and inference, the principal reason which gave a kick to CAA, otherwise there is no reason to be so hurried about CAA. You have just won an election. Your economy is doing 4.9%. Most people think it's a fudged figure. It is actually 4.5%. Most people actually think it's 4%. But I am giving you the benefit of doubt, it's 4.5%. By the way, most of you don't know that the economy on the nominal basis, which is unadjusted for inflation, is 7.23. 7.23 is the lowest in 25 years. There are two figures. 7.23 is unadjusted, 4.9 is adjusted for inflation. So 4.9 is low anyway. But 7.23 has always been 14, 15, 12 before adjusting for inflation. And this is the lowest figure in 25 years. So what is the reason why you are not thinking of these things and suddenly going for CAA? There is only one reason. That reason was like the cat which came out of the bag. But when it came out of the bag, the person who was holding the bag didn't realize the kind of reaction it would lead to. So only in the last 1 week, that person who was holding the bag, his boss, who's number one in the country, is trying desperately to put the cat back inside the bag. Now cats can go out, they can't come inside the bag so easily. I'll tell you what and how. The reason for CAA was that there has been a move in Assam for many years to not have illegal entrants. And there is nothing to do with religion. It is to do with Assamese and non-Assamese. You are living far away in Kerala, but you know in Assam, there is a Hindu Assamese, there is a Muslim Assamese. There are, of course, tribal Assamese. All three are opposed to a Muslim non-Assamese. All three are opposed to a Hindu non-Assamese. I hope I am clear. The test is Assamese, non-Assamese, not Hindu-Muslim. Now there, the promise in the legislation was 1971 cutoff. NRC was to be done. Ultimately, the Supreme Court, somewhat brutally and arbitrarily, under the supervision of the previous Chief Justice, partly wrongly, perhaps he should not have dealt with the matter because he is from Assam, did it in a hurry. That chapter is over. But the important thing why it links to the CAA is because that found 19 lakh persons who could not account for their citizenship. People were about to clap, aha, we have found 19 lakh illegal immigrants. Just as they were about to clap, somebody found out that 12 odd lakh of those 19, somebody says 13, somebody says 12, were Hindus. Now when that pinged them within the country, otherwise you'd have to deport 19 lakhs on the last count, including 12 lakh Hindus. The villains, the Muslims, were only possibly 5, 6, 7 lakhs, 5 lakhs, 6 lakhs, and then 1 or 2 lakhs were tribals and other people. Now this, to some extent, the palliative and the answer is the CAA. Because if you are able to show that you are a Hindu from Bangladesh, you will get some relief. Why also? Because that date is 71, this date is 2014. I know it's a little technical, but you're all lawyers. And it's your off day today, so you should be subjected to some blackmailing pressure, hard work. So 2014 will cover everybody. The moment, now this was done actually to help a community or a group of people in Assam. It boomeranged again because they didn't realize that the Assamese Hindu is dead opposed to the non-Assamese Hindu. So Assam erupted. Did you know that 1/3 of office bearers of the ruling party have resigned in Assam? Forget Congress, forget left, forget TMC. Ruling party have resigned. Did you know that the 56-inch powerful number one did not go 3 days ago to Assam to inaugurate Khel India, Khelo India? Did you know that? Khelo India was not inaugurated. 56-inch powerful. Unbeatable by anyone, could not go to his own state. Ruled by the redoubtable Hemanta Biswa Sarma and the redoubtable Sonowal. He could not visit Khelo India. He could not inaugurate Khelo India. The Japanese Prime Minister Abe, the best friend of our Honorable Prime Minister, could not go to Assam about 2 months ago. Why? Is it because the Congress is making it difficult to go to Assam? Now, these are real issues because, now let me complete the picture. You never expected this. You created a CAA to do what you thought will help your constituency in Assam. It boomeranged. Thereafter, you announced 9 times. Now this is, I tell you, according to me, it's the worst form of chicanery. If you were doing a case of 420 criminal law, 415, 415, 420, you'd be able to call it cheating. But you can't file a cheating case against Prime Minister or Home Minister. I'll tell you why. So the cat was out of the bag when you did this CA. Then after that, the cat was allowed to run all over the country because 9 times on the record, we have the date, the video, the statement, the Home Minister said, this country is going to have a national NRC. I don't have to prove it. I think you people read newspapers every day. How many times the Home Minister has said? 9 times on newspaper, print and video over the last 6 months. Again and again and again. Pre-election and immediately after election of 2019. Now, after all this erupted, that Assam is in flames, and the whole of the rest of the country looks at you with suspicion. Then, by one of those 1.5 people, a process started of trying to put you back, the cat back in the bag, for a short while, to quieten tempers. So the Honorable Prime Minister made a fantastic statement 1 week ago. The Honorable Prime Minister said 1 week ago, but the NRC, the National NRC, has never been discussed in the Cabinet or in Parliament. So I tweeted that day. I tweeted. It's on record the same day. I said, Honorable Prime Minister and Honorable Home Minister should not talk like lawyers. They should not put qualifications and caveats. It is like saying that you did something which you never did. Who has said that it's been discussed in Cabinet? Who has said it's been discussed in Parliament? Of course, we all know that. I said, the real question is, are you going to do a national NRC or not? To which Mr. Amit Shah answered that we will discuss it, we have not discussed it yet. He did not say no, we will not do an NRC. Mr. Hardeep Puri, a minister who might get into some trouble, made a statement 2 days ago, you should believe the Prime Minister because he is boss. I don't know how number two will hear that. He should be careful, he should be forewarned, and he is in some dangerous territory. I wish him well because he managed to get my return ticket on the flight which was full today from Kerala. He's a Minister of Civil Aviation also. But today, therefore, there is an attempt to backtrack for the first time. There is an attempt to put the cat back in the bag. Not to actually abandon the NRC, just to fudge the issue, to camouflage the issue, to let it lie low for a while and then bring it back with a bang. That is why these lawyer-like caveats and stipulations and qualifications and provisos and explanations. We have not discussed NRC in the Cabinet or in the Parliament. Friends, when the debate started on NRC and on CAA, for the first week or so, the Home Minister constantly talked of partition. Look at partition. How many persecuted Hindus we accommodated? Please ask yourself, put your hand on your heart, is it a fair example for the Honorable Home Minister to give? Is it a fair example? You had the most awesome partition and division of a country ever in the history of mankind. I forget the number, millions of people, never larger, transmigrated from this way to that way to this way. Two countries were created in less than few months. There was chaos, killings. Is that the same as doing this CAA and NRC? Could India say no to people coming dead in trains? And could Pakistan say no to people coming dead in trains in their side? So why is partition given? Because the Home Minister doesn't realize that he does a hit wicket. The moment he talks of partition, he precisely does the reason why partition occurred. It's all very well to abuse Nehru, to abuse Gandhi, which you do every day. But the basic reason for partition was because one Mr. Jinnah, a very successful lawyer by the way, said that either you give separate electorates, or separate electorates mean in a same constituency Muslims vote for Muslims only, or you make a loose confederation of five group states. So five states in northwest India, five in east India, five in north India, five in south India. Each is a confederation, each is a ruled by, and all powers are in these five groups which are independent countries with a loose head country India which has got only communication and foreign affairs. Now Gandhi and Nehru's main problem was they said we will not accept the issue of Hindus for Hindus, Muslims for Muslims. That is why partition occurred. The very same reason you are now bringing back by making, of course it's a smaller example, but the reason is the same. The CAA on the basis of religion. Lohia, who used to hate the Congress and abuse the Congress frequently, said this, and I quote Ram Manohar Lohia, those who have shouted loudest about Akhand Bharat, the present Janasangh and its predecessors of the surrounding un-Hindu spirit of Hinduism have helped bodies like the Muslim League partition the country in 1947. It is this very thought process. Savarkar, who no doubt was a nationalist in some ways, But he strongly subscribed to the two-nation theory. Why should we be scared of saying so? Now, I may disagree with you, you may not like me, but do you subscribe to the two-nation theory? If you don't, then this act is also based on religion. It is based on that two-nation theory. The JPC, the report on the Citizenship Amendment Act, which came just before this act was brought in, has a very interesting paragraph. Several legal experts were consulted and they said that this proposed CAA is unconstitutional. They don't name the legal experts, so I call them unnamed legal experts. But that advice was not followed, because to follow advice, you need humility. You need humility. And there is no humility, so what is to be done? Friends, the NPR, I want to spend a few minutes on. Now, it is true that the NPR, so we've done the NRC, we've done the CAA, or the CAA and the NRC. Now the NPR. As you know, the National Population Register by itself is no problem. It has no, we have been doing it for many years, it's been doing it. It used to be a collection of information. Why is there so much furor now? And this is important. First, the larger principle. When there is distrust, when there is suspicion, when there is lack of faith, even the right thing rightly starts looking wrong. If I have no faith in you and you want to do the right thing, even then I'll be rightly suspicious of you. So first and foremost, which the ruler should realize, there is a lack of faith in the regime of this country by the people of India. So even if they shout from the rooftops that NPR is nothing, nobody will believe them. Second, NPR is not nothing. It's important. What is the basic point? The basic point is that the NPR is intended to be nothing more and nothing less than a itemization of where you live and where you reside. It is not intended to do anything with citizenship. It is only a listing of where you live, where you reside. But this government has repeatedly linked it in official statements to the NRC. And the NRC has been expanded to be a national NRC. And the national NRC has been expanded to be in the CAA. So while the Congress also had NPR, we never had a national NRC. We never had a CAA. Now when you have all three together, you are bound to be accused that you are going to use NPR. Today, you are not going to use NPR to list where you reside. You are going to use NPR to first list where you reside and then ask the next question, because now it's very interesting. This new NPR, for the first time, asks a question, not only where you live and reside, but where do your parents live and reside? This, by the way, is a change. Why this question? Why? Why is it that in the 2018-19 annual report of the Ministry of Home Affairs, 18-19, I quote, it says, National Population Register is the first step towards the creation of the National Register of Indian Citizens under the provisions of the aforesaid statute. And now that NRC is linked with the CAA, Mr. Kiran Rijiju has time and again on Parliament said, and I'll read this last statement in 2014 and the one after that in 2016. He said, I quote, the demographic data for NPR has already been collected for the entire country and also digitized, creating an electronic database of 118 crores. The government has now decided to create the National Register of Indian Citizens based on the information collected under the scheme of NPR. By verifying the citizenship status of all individuals in the country. This is the Minister Kiran Rijiju on Parliament. What are we talking about? So, this is a fold step. In our time, it was a single step. Step one, collect data in NPR, which was there in our time also. But we did not ask where your parents live, where they were born. Second step, that if you don't give an answer properly, about parents and living, then you are put in a category of doubtful citizens. Third step, you are put into the NRIC grinder where questions are asked. And fourth step, some of you are given citizenship in CA, some of you are denied. Friends, therefore, this is as far as I wanted to speak on citizenship. Now I'll ask you a frank question. I didn't realize I went a little slowly. I have two issues left and it'll take a lot of time, so I don't want to waste your time. I have custodial death and I have administration of justice. That is arrears mounting, both of relevance to law and public life. If I rush, I can do it in 20 minutes. If you want, I can do one of them. You should be frank. I need not do both. I can do one in 10, 12 minutes. Or I can do both in 20 minutes. Let me try and do a custodial death first very quickly. Shall I? Custodial death is important. Another reason why there is a connectivity between Kerala. And I discovered when Asaf Ali mentioned it, close connectivity with me, personally. We all know that in the name of encounters, bad things happen across the country, whether they happen in Uttar Pradesh, whether they happen in Hyderabad, or they happen in Kerala. The heart of the matter is deaths in police custody. The largest number is those. That includes custodial death and custodial torture. Why there is a link? Of course, there are lots of allegations of that I find in Kerala. There are recent allegations in Kerala, which I will not go into, but you are well aware of it. But let us look at it legally, and this is very interesting. Way back in 1987, a sitting judge of Calcutta High Court, his name was sitting judge, D.K. Basu. He was number two to the Chief Justice, but as you know, number two is made the head of the Legal Services Authority. So as the chairman of the Legal Services Authority of West Bengal, he wrote a letter about the great concern about increasing deaths in police custody to the Supreme Court in 87. The letter was treated as a writ petition, and in 87, a young lawyer called Abhishek Singhvi, who was not then a senior, I became a senior in 1991, was appointed amicus curiae by the Supreme Court in 87. So when he mentioned custodial deaths, it came home straight to me. I collected information, then you know you have to give a reply, rejoinder, notice to states. All the states in the country were given notice. Each state sought time 2-3 times. 7 interim directions were issued. I'm summarizing and shortening it. There are a total of 9 DK Basus, 2 are detailed judgments, one in 97, one in 2015. In between are 7 more, which are directions given. So I have lived with this case from 87 to 2015. In 87, I was 37 years old, 38 years old. And I lived in 2015 when the case ended. I was amicus. The basic question which I raised as amicus was, that is all very well to all of us to give a lecture, say, don't kill people in custody. You be careful. I will hit you. I will punish you. I will suspend you. I will sack you. The crucial way is preventive first and then punitive. There are two aspects, preventive and punitive. How do you prevent? Nobody can prevent. Every country will have custodial deaths. How can you minimize custody deaths? Minimization, I told the court, I said, there are various safeguards I will give you. But all the safeguards fail on one point. In our country and most other countries, after I show the arrest of this man, then all the safeguards apply. See, once I arrest you, then Miranda warnings apply in USA. Your lawyer can meet you in India. Your relative has to be informed. You have to be taken for a medical checkup. But most custodial deaths occur before I show the arrest. So I pick up Asaf Ali today. I do bad things to him and show his arrest after 2 days. All the bad things happen in those 2 days. So the question is how to, and we had no answer, but the 1997, the first main order of D.K. Basu, the court was kind enough to say, during the course of hearing the writ petitions, the court felt necessity of having assistance from the bar, and Dr. A.M. Singhvi was requested to assist the court. Then they say, there's a long judgment, I'm not reading it. They took it through all the material, and they then cited Joginder Kumar and Nilabati Behra, which is compensation, and ultimately they gave these 10 commandments of D.K. Basu, which I am proud to say in 1997 were drafted by me, given by me as a written submission to the court, and adopted by the court with a specific mention of my name and thanking me. And those are, as you know, the police personnel carrying out arrest and handling of interrogation should bear accurate, visible and clear identification. His arrest must be recorded in register. Number two, they must prepare an arrest memo which shall be attested by at least one witness who must be a member of the family. It must be countersigned by the arrestee. Three, a person who has been detained shall be entitled to have one friend or relative or other person informed as soon as practicable and not later than so-and-so. Four, the time, arrest and venue of the arrestee must be notified to the next friend and to the local legal aid association. Five, the person must be made aware of his rights. Six, and like this, for those of you, I'm not reading it for saving time. 10, I call them the 10 commandments of D.K. Basu, which started in 87 and this judgment in 1997. Then they had a second part which says, this is preventive, but if you are found guilty, then you will give compensation. The state must give compensation and the state can recover it from the delinquent police officer later on. That's the second part of the judgment, and I will not read it, but I will read, for purpose of vanity, the last part of the judgment. Before parting with this judgment, we wish to place on record our appreciation for the learned counsel appearing for the states and for Dr. Abhishek Singhvi, learned senior counsel who assisted the court in particular, and for the valuable assistance and written submissions given by him. Now, this having been done, we then started monitoring as the amicus curiae what happened to these directions. So from 97 to about 2005, I monitored them. Then it was to be decided in 2007-8, but states did not respond. So we filed an IA saying, in the light of what is happening, we made a chart for all states. And ultimately, it went to the detailed judgment of 2015 on 24th July 2015 by Chief Justice Thakur. He was then judge number 3. And he described the whole history, and ultimately he cited the 7 orders and he concluded, I'm again cutting it short, so I stick to my 10 minutes on this, which is just getting over on this. And he said, to sum up, one, and this was important for monitoring because the Supreme Court found that they cannot monitor across the country. Who monitors custodial death? The state human rights commissions. We found that state human rights commissions did not exist in 50% states. And the 50% states which had state human rights commission, no appointments were made. So they were defunct, dead. Second thing I said in my written submissions the second time is, why not have CCTVs in all prisons? And ultimately in also police stations. Third thing was something more, and there was a lot of debate on all this. To cut it short, this is what they said. To sum up, the states of Delhi, Himachal, Mizoram, Arunachal, Meghalaya, Tripura, Nagaland shall within 6 months from today set up the state human rights. Imagine Delhi did not have a state human rights commission. Delhi did not have. All vacancies in every state for the post of chairperson or member must be immediately filled up. Then they give various other directions. Then they say, the state government shall take steps to install CCTV in all prisons in their respective states within a period of 1 year, not later than 2 years. Effort should be made to install CCTV not only in prisons but also in police stations. Time-bound inquiry for culpability. Now, yes, we are in trouble. We have bad examples. But remember, at the end of the day, we are much better off. Today, when you go to a police station, under this order which I got, every police station has to display the D.K. Basu. Every police officer is a little bit worried. So today, although there are terrible deaths, what all of you as lawyers have to do is to file applications in courts based on the 2 D.K. Basu judgments and get orders in individual cases. Everything is not done by the Supreme Court. The structure is here. The commandments are here. The rules are here. The 20 suggestions are here. But you as activists can now rely on these directions and punish delinquency in every part of the country and in Kerala. Friends, I have run out of time, but give me 5 minutes more and I'm done. It would have taken half an hour, but I'm not taking that time. One thing I want to take 5 minutes or 7 minutes on, and that is what troubles me, that India is one of the finest countries as far as our legal system is concerned. I have traveled all over the world. I have talked to judges and lawyers everywhere. According to me, our judges and our lawyers at each level are the best and the brightest. But, and according to me, the latest, most advanced doctrines of law have been invented in India. The kind of judicial review you have in India, you have nowhere in the world by a factor of 10. We have humongous judicial review. America is nothing, England is nothing, no country in the world has judicial review like we do. Not even a fraction. The inventor of the basic structure doctrine is India. Can you imagine a doctrine which Palkhivala helped in creating, which says that even a constitutional amendment can be unconstitutional? Can you imagine the depth of vision for a doctrine like this? Even a constitutional amendment can be unconstitutional. That is now, of course, being followed by various other countries, but it was invented by India. Then PIL, invented by India entirely. So many other doctrines. And yet we hang our head in shame when we find 3.5 or 3.25 crore cases pending in this country. That's the one thing. So reforms in the administration of justice is most important. And this relates to the A, B, C, D of litigation and justice and administration, where A stands for access, B stands for backlog, C stands for cost, and D stands for delay. And today, after so many years, we are still suffering. And if I tell you the reasons for which I don't have full time, it is laughable. We are suffering for reasons which are so silly as to be trivial, childish. To give you one reason, in a country of 1.25 billion people, you can assume safely a litigating public of at least 300 million. I'm understating it, it may be more. Let us assume 200 million. For 200 million people, do you know the number of high court judges we have across the country? The total number of judges in the country in the strength of the High Court is 1,079. Strength. Do you know how many are appointed for the whole country? 676 posts. That is a few months ago. Do you know how many are vacant? 414. Do you know the percentage of 414 to 179? 40%. Now you are giving seminars, lectures about arrears, pendency, 10 years, 5 years, fast track courts. 40% of your high court judiciary is vacant. Lower court judiciary, where many of you practice in the districts, 25% is vacant. I have the figures. 22,000, 16,000 filled, 5,000-6,000 vacant. 25% vacant, and this is at any point of time from independence till today, average vacancy. Can you have excellent hospital buildings, latest infrastructure and machines and cardiography and X-ray machines, and no doctors? And you are talking of treating of patients. So, and in this, I blame squarely first the judiciary. The judiciary took the power from them to us. We will appoint judges. We are the judiciary, we will appoint judges. And then you have 40% vacancy in the country for high court judges. You have 25% vacancy in a country of 1.25 billion, where you practice the cutting edge. The common man's first touch with justice is that lower judiciary. 25 to 33%, I have the figures. So first failure is judiciary. Why? The politics of the judiciary will make the politics of politicians blush. Politicians will blush if they see the politics the judiciary plays. We find the most appropriate person to be appointed, and then we find ways of disappointing him or her. Not appointing him or her, disappointing him or her. So you will have vacancies of 40%, 33%. And you have not a simple thing like 100% appointments. I have written 15 years ago, I'm only repeating myself. I said have a rule whereby one office only under the Chief Justice of India, monitors appointments. Every day he sends a warning, look, Mr. District Judge Asaf Ali, in your court, next 3 months there are going to be so-and-so vacancies. Before that, the names must come 3 months in advance. And so you have to monitor. 2 months in advance, they must be appointed. And I have proposed that 1 month before the retirement of the incumbent, the successor should be notified. It is so simple. Is it rocket science I'm talking about? 1 month before you retire, your successor should be notified. Why can't we do it? Because we don't think like administrators, like management experts. We think like politicians. She's a good person. Let us disappoint her, not appoint her. Why not to appoint you is the process, not why to appoint you or how to appoint you. Then, have we tried simple things like Article 224A? Not many of you have read it, please go and read it. There's an article in the Constitution, 224A, inserted in 1960 or 63. If you are fighting and having so much politics, because I find a new person to be appointed as so much politics, I find this man is good, moment I find you good, then everybody, all your friends start abusing you. I can't appoint you. Delay. People start making complaints against you. So till you are fighting, you have a provision in 224 to appoint ad hoc judges. Ad hoc judges is something so simple, from the same high court or even from another high court, the Chief Justice with the consent of the central government can appoint. Now these existing high court judges or retired judges, they can be both retired or from this high court or that high court, are already tried and tested people. Do you know that in 70 years or since it came into 60 years, in 60 years of our history, only four have been appointed, all to the Supreme Court only, ad hoc judges. Not a single ad hoc judge that I know has been appointed to the High Court. 40% vacancy, are bhai, if you can't agree on a name, if this man is retired, appoint him ad hoc judge for 6 months more. That vacancy will at least function. These are so simple that they make me cry. And I will end now, because I have taken too much of your time, by a rather scathing, somewhat insulting to India quotation, but so true, by a man who was one of the most brilliant lawyers, Nani Palkhivala. Because I believe, and he said, that words must be an assault on the senses for reform to occur. Reform will not happen unless words are an assault on your senses. And therefore I end on arrears, on backlog, on the ABCD, on access, on backlog, on cost and delay of administration of justice by this quotation by Nani Palkhivala, made about 40 years ago, 30 years ago. And is it not tragic that this lament of India's most eminent jurist applies even today? I quote, he said about 30, 35 years ago, may I turn now to the situation in India, which has the second largest number of lawyers in the world. While it is true that justice should be blind, in our country it is also lame. It barely manages to hobble along. The law may or may not be an ass, but in India it is certainly a snail. It moves at a pace which would be regarded as unduly slow in a community of snails. A lawsuit once started in India is the nearest thing to eternal life ever seen on earth. Some have said that litigation in India is a form of fairly harmless entertainment. But if that is so, it seems to be a very expensive way of keeping the citizenry amused. If litigation were to be included in the next Olympics, India would be quite certain of winning a gold medal. Friends, thank you for your patience. Ellavarkum ente nanni.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. given by the Muslim God who have contributed to the mosque. All the
നമ്മുടെ അഭിമാനമായ മനു അഭിഷേക് സിംഗ് ജി, വേദിയിൽ ഉപസ്ഥിതരായിരിക്കുന്ന വിശിഷ്ട വ്യക്തികളെ, സഹോദരി സഹോദരന്മാരെ, സുഹൃത്തുക്കളെ, നമ്മുടെ രാജ്യം ഒരു മതേതര ജനാധിപത്യ റിപ്പബ്ലിക്കായി തുടരുമോ എന്ന് ആശങ്കപ്പെടുന്ന ഒരു സാഹചര്യത്തിലൂടെയാണ് നാം കടന്നുപോയിക്കൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നത്. രാജ്യസഭയുടെ പ്രതിപക്ഷ നേതാവ്, കോൺഗ്രസ് നേതാവും മുൻ മുഖ്യമന്ത്രിയുമായ ശ്രീ ഗുലാം നബി ആസാദ് കാശ്മീർ വിഷയത്തിൽ കൊടുത്ത ഹർജിയിൽ സുപ്രീം കോടതിയിൽ നിന്നും അനുകൂലമായ ഒരു വിധി, ഇന്റർനെറ്റ് മൗലികമായ അവകാശമാണെന്നും മനുഷ്യാവകാശ ലംഘനങ്ങൾ അംഗീകരിക്കുവാൻ സാധ്യമല്ല എന്നുള്ള വിധി വന്നു എന്നതിൻ്റെ പേരിൽ മാത്രം ജുഡീഷ്യറിയിൽ ഉണ്ടായിരിക്കുന്ന അനഭിലഷേധമായ പ്രവണതകൾ നമുക്കൊരിക്കലും പൊറുക്കുവാൻ കഴിയുന്നതല്ല. ജാമിയ മിലിയ സർവകലാശാലയിൽ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികൾക്ക് നേരെ മനുഷ്യാവകാശ ലംഘനങ്ങൾ നടക്കുകയും വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളെ ക്രൂരമായി മർദ്ദിക്കുകയും ചെയ്ത സംഭവത്തിൽ സീനിയർ അഭിഭാഷകർ സുപ്രീം കോടതിയെ സമീപിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഒരു കേസ് രജിസ്റ്റർ ചെയ്യണമെന്നും മുതിർന്ന അഭിഭാഷകരെ അലിഗഡ് മുസ്ലിം സർവകലാശാലയിലേക്ക് അയക്കണമെന്നും ആവശ്യപ്പെട്ടപ്പോൾ സുപ്രീം കോടതി എടുത്ത സമീപനം നമ്മെ നിരാശപ്പെടുത്തുന്നതാണ്. ജാമിയ മിലിയ സർവകലാശാലയിൽ ഉണ്ടായ സംഭവത്തിൽ സുപ്രീം കോടതിയുടെ ഭാഗത്തു നിന്നും ഒരു ഇടപെടലിൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു എങ്കിൽ ജെ എൻ യുവിൽ ഉണ്ടായ സംഭവം ഒഴിവാക്കാൻ സാധിക്കുമായിരുന്നു. ജവഹർലാൽ നെഹ്റു യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിൽ അർദ്ധരാത്രിയിൽ സാമൂഹ്യ വിരുദ്ധന്മാർ, സംഘികൾ, ABVP പ്രവർത്തകന്മാർ കടന്നുകയറി മുഖം മൂടി ധരിച്ച് നടത്തിയ അക്രമ സംഭവങ്ങൾ ആവർത്തിക്കില്ലായിരുന്നു. ഇന്ന് ഭയത്തിൻ്റെ അന്തരീക്ഷം നിലനിൽക്കുന്നു. നമ്മുടെ എക്സിക്യൂട്ടീവിന് പിന്തുണയ്ക്കുന്ന നിലയിൽ ഭരണകൂടത്തെ അനുകൂലിക്കുന്ന സമീപനം ജുഡീഷ്യറി പലപ്പോഴും സ്വീകരിക്കുന്നു എന്നത് ഗൗരവമുള്ള വിഷയമാണ്. നമ്മുടെ ജുഡീഷ്യറിയുടെ ചരിത്രത്തിൽ ആദ്യമായി 4 ജഡ്ജിമാർ സുപ്രീം കോടതിയുടെ തിരുമുറ്റത്ത് നടത്തിയ മാധ്യമ സമ്മേളനത്തിൽ പറഞ്ഞ കാര്യങ്ങൾ, രഞ്ജൻ ഗൊഗോയ് ചീഫ് ജസ്റ്റിസായി വന്നപ്പോൾ, ആ പത്രസമ്മേളനം നടത്തിയ ജഡ്ജി ചീഫ് ജസ്റ്റിസ് ആയപ്പോൾ ഈ പറഞ്ഞ കാര്യങ്ങൾക്ക് ഒരു പരിഹാരമുണ്ടാകുമെന്ന് ന്യായമായി പ്രതീക്ഷിച്ചു എങ്കിലും യാതൊരുവിധമായ പരിഹാരമുണ്ടാക്കുവാനും കഴിഞ്ഞില്ല എന്ന് മാത്രമല്ല, നരേന്ദ്രമോദിയുടെ ഭരണകൂടത്തെ അനവസരത്തിൽ പിന്തുണയ്ക്കുന്ന നിലപാടുകൾ സ്വീകരിക്കുന്നത് നമ്മൾ കണ്ടു. BH ലോയയുടെ ദുരൂഹ മരണത്തെപ്പറ്റി യാതൊരുവിധമായ അന്വേഷണം നടത്തുവാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞില്ല. നമ്മുടെ ജുഡീഷ്യറി നേരിടുന്ന ഇത്തരം വെല്ലുവിളികളെ അഭിമുഖീകരിക്കുവാനും ഭരണഘടനാ മൂല്യങ്ങൾ കാത്തു സംരക്ഷിക്കുവാനും ജനാധിപത്യപരമായ അവകാശങ്ങൾ സംരക്ഷിക്കുവാനും കഴിയുന്നത് അഭിഭാഷകർക്കാണ്. സ്വാതന്ത്ര്യസമര കാലഘട്ടത്തിൽ അഭിഭാഷകരാണ് ഈ അവകാശങ്ങൾ കൊളോണിയൽ ഭരണകൂടത്തിൽ നിന്നും നേടിയെടുത്തതെന്നുള്ള വസ്തുത ഈ അവസരത്തിൽ സൂചിപ്പിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഇന്ന് നടക്കുന്ന ഇത്തരം തെറ്റായ നടപടികൾക്കെതിരെയുള്ള പോരാട്ട മുഖങ്ങളിൽ പങ്കെടുക്കുവാൻ എത്തിയിരിക്കുന്ന അഭിഭാഷക സമൂഹത്തിന് എല്ലാവിധമായ ആശംസയും അഭിവാദ്യങ്ങളും കേരള പ്രദേശ് കോൺഗ്രസ് കമ്മിറ്റിയുടെ പേരിൽ നേർന്നുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ വാക്കുകൾ ഉപസംഹരിക്കുന്നു. നമസ്കാരം. ജയ് ഹിന്ദ്.
I have 3 questions to you. The first one is, all over the world we are discussing the growth of ultra-neg. Joseph Stanley, in his How Fascism Works, he mentions especially the Hindutva regime, which shows all signs of a fascist regime. In that context, people here clearly apprehend that CAA, NRC and NPR, they are all steps towards the construction of a Hindu Rashtra. How do you place all these three in the context of the construction of Hindu Rashtra? That's my first question. The second question is that if they are marching towards Hindutva Rashtra with a kind of nonchalance, they are not bothered about any protest that is going on in the country, will the Supreme Court be able to stop this? Because we feel that we have the protection of the basic structure of the constitution, but without touching the word secular and without touching the basic structure, they are coming up with all these laws. So will they be able to, will the present political dispensation be able to subvert the basic structure of the constitution and secularism? And will they be successful in marching towards Hindu Rashtra? If they are successful, will the Supreme Court be able to block them? And the Supreme Court will be willing to block them. And if the third question, if the Supreme Court is not willing to block them and is not able to block them, where are we heading towards? We have 4.5 years for the BJP regime. How long the protests will continue? That is a political question. What do you expect for the country to take? Where are we heading towards if we are not able to block them? Thank you, sir.
True. Then the answer is contained in your third question itself. God help us. But I am certainly not pessimistic. By the way, a joke about optimists and pessimists. And I don't want to sound like that kind of optimist, but I'm still optimistic. The joke about optimists and pessimists is that two of them together, one was an optimist, one was a pessimist, fell down from Empire State Building together. And they were both hurtling down to certain destruction from Empire State Building, the tallest building in those days. So somewhere around 100 feet above the ground, the pessimist asked the optimist, he says, what now, as your third question says, what will happen? So the optimist said, so far so good. Now, I am not that kind of optimist. I am an optimist based on hard facts. The way to deal with what you call ultra-nationalist or fascist is first and foremost to not only use those adjectives. Not even to use Hindu National Rashtra. Words have are evocative. They have meaning. They conjure up various images. You have to use these phrases once in a while, but you must always, and by you I mean lawyers, I mean professionals, who are the enlightened sections of society who have training. You must back it up with examples, with events, with illustrations. Because what remains with an audience is not the adjective fascist. When every time you see, you say Hindu Rashtra, I will call you, oh, ye to BJP virodhi hai. Every time you say fascist, you will say he's a Congress supporter. You must say it once in a while. But you must give concrete examples to jog the awareness of the audience you are talking to. And people relate to examples, to events, to consequences, not to adjectives. I think the second question is the real one. Not only the Supreme Court, which is your second question, but the whole of India. Of course, anything is possible, I can't predict. I think India inherently will not allow that kind of stage to come, which is your doomsday scenario. And if by chance we are inching towards it, the Supreme Court certainly will not allow it. The Supreme Court should not be looked at by you and me as the only bastion of our liberties. That's the first mistake you are making. There is no reason why a country as diverse as India, as democratic as India, as accountable as India, where institutions have taken root, the only difference between India and Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, other countries, the principal difference is that a large number of institutions have taken root. So civil society, if it stands up, speaks up, gives examples, will be able to stop it. If civil society cannot, then certainly the Supreme Court will. And there is no question of basic structure being violated, because by definition, basic structure is what the Supreme Court says it is. and basic structure by definition can't be amended. So a dictatorial government cannot say we declare this not to be or to be part of the basic structure. Yes, we need to have faith in our judges. We need to believe that they will not allow such a thing to pass. And I can tell you that it is not going to be easy. After all, as I end the answer to your question, I am reminded that in the last 1 year, 1.5, well, actually 2 years, with all this psychosis of fear, with all this onslaught of fear amongst judges, don't forget, I was the one who argued Uttarakhand, High Court level. I was the one who argued Karnataka, the midnight matter he mentioned. We got orders. I was the one who argued Karnataka 2, where although we lost because of lack of majority, we did not allow the speaker to be superseded. We were the one who got Maharashtra. The court has intervened. Yesterday the court has intervened in Jammu and Kashmir. So I think it's no point transferring your responsibility by saying, oh, the Supreme Court is at fault. First, you must discharge your responsibility as civil society. I think we have enough institutions to kick back. All is not lost. And then, of course, you have the last bastion of the basic structure in the Supreme Court.
Yes, first the protest started in Jamia Millia. And I may be wrong, or I may be, because I'm asking if at that moment itself, if the Supreme Court has interfered and passed a status quo order, we could have prevented all these after subsequent events. Then, and the second is that yesterday, no, earlier the Supreme Court said that as such there is no act or no, it's only a bill passed by the parliament and there is no act. But yesterday that act came into force. Now, whether the Supreme Court will interfere or we, the people, will get a fair judgment.
All very easy in a large monolith country like India to put everything at the door of the Supreme Court. Students issue and JNU, why didn't the Supreme Court interfere? Some breakages in Kerala, why didn't the Supreme Court interfere? No, you have to have faith in yourself, and ultimately the Supreme Court is not created to deal with every issue. According to me, they are already dealing with far too much. And when you overload an institution, what happens is actually the reverse. Number one, it snaps. But number two is more important. It starts legitimizing. When you file everything in the Supreme Court, the first answer which will come is, not maintainable, go to the High Courts. So I don't think this kind of knee-jerk reaction is required. What is required is people speaking up, people writing. Let me give an example. We were talking just now, my friend and I. D.K. Basu gives you two Supreme Court charters of liberty. One and two. There are 10 commandments and there are 10 more commandments. So 20 commandments as charters of liberty. Now, do you expect the Supreme Court to monitor every violation of D.K. Basu in the country because Supreme Court gave those two charters? Today in a police station in Kollam, there is no CCTV. And you are being bashed up every day in the police station. You should go straight to Supreme Court saying your commandment is being violated. And then you must say that Supreme Court could not interfere, therefore we have no Supreme Court to protect us. Now, I will give you an alternative model. Why don't each one of you identify gross violations of human rights in your district? And in your district, file a petition in the district court saying, in this jail, this direction number 2 and 6 is being violated. Please immediately inquire and punish. That will operationalize D.K. Basu across the country if all of you district people did it. So my answer is, therefore, students, ultimately the issue will reach the Supreme Court. But there has to be a system to it. Don't overload everything into one cart. And secondly, the CAA is under challenge. We filed a petition last year. I am in one of the lead matters myself. The judge is aware of it. Coming into force doesn't mean much because it takes time to operationalize it. People are not yet being subjected to it. But yes, I understand your view that there must be a reasonable degree of urgency. And I think we will be mentioning it to the Chief Justice. After Sabarimala, etc., he is likely to put a date for hearing the matter.
Our holy book is our constitution itself. But as a secular country, we have many religions and many holy books. But when a question of law arises, between an aspect of religion and the constitutionality, we were giving more weightage to religious aspects than the wide constitutional aspects. So my question is, how we balance between the religious aspects and the constitutional aspects, which need more weightage in our country in the today's?
On constitutional law, on Article 25. Now, your question relates to the constitutional balance between freedom of religion versus secularism and how that constitutional balance is struck. You understand that I cannot answer that question in a limited time, but let me give you a quick answer. My own view is that if you read judgments of the Supreme Court, and you will have to be a serious student to read all that, from Shirur Math 1954 right down to all the judgments till now, including Sabarimala, which discusses all of them, including so many more, you will find that the Supreme Court has made every effort to strike the right balance between religion and constitutional values. We are not a state which says, there are two approaches to religion. A constitution may say, this state is anti-religion. This state is irreligious. Religion, if you practice here, we will punish it. That was the Chinese model at one time. The other model is, which we have adopted in Article 25, that we are a secular nation, but our definition of secularism is that all religions will flourish, all religions will be allowed to be fully practiced, but A, there will be no state religion, and B, you will be able to interfere in religions on stated grounds in Article 25 or 27, 29, etc. I think that balance has been worked out in so many cases, starting from Shirur Math. For example, to give you a small little example and end my point, a lawyer in the 80s or 90s, I forget when, said that I am an Anand Margi. He was actually a practicing lawyer in the Supreme Court, I knew him. He said, Anand Margi is, I am an Anand Margi. Then he said, Anand Marg is a different sect of Hinduism. It is arisen from Hinduism, but it's a different religion. Third, he said that Anand Margis have to take out a procession every year. And fourth, he said, in the procession it is mandatory because of our religion. Our religion is Anand Margi religion. You have to do a Tandav Nritya, dance of Tandav. And last, in that dance of Tandav, you have to carry a Trishul. I hope you have heard me. Now the police commissioner said that I will not allow a Trishul, because you can't dance on the streets of Kolkata with a Trishul. It's a law and order situation. So he filed a matter saying, this is my fundamental right to religion. Question arose, and this is the way it is analyzed, and I think it's been analyzed, you know, in an individual case, the analysis may be wrong or right, but the approach is correct. So the court question number one, is Anand Marg a religion? Answer, no. If Anand Marg is religion, then I am a Jain. So Digambar is also religion, Shvetambar is also religion, Tirapanti is also religion. You are a Muslim, Shia is also religion, Somini is also religion, everybody is a different religion. So first answer is Anand Marg is not a religion. So the matter ends. You don't get protection under 25. Second, they said, if it is a religion, please show to me that dancing once a year with a Trishul is an essential part of the religion. Obviously, it is not an essential part of any religion that once a year you must dance with a Trishul. So again, the answer is no. So they said, if that is so, the police commissioner is fully entitled to prohibit it. Now, suppose the question was, a Sikh says, I want to carry my kirpan in my turban, and the police commissioner says the kirpan is a threat, then he'll be able to invoke 25. Why? Because the five principles of Sikhism includes the carrying of a kirpan. That's the way you analyze case to case. Now I agree with you, in 10% cases the Supreme Court must have got it wrong. But by and large, even if they've got it right in 75% of cases, in a country as diverse as India, India is the planet Earth's most diverse spot. We have more religions, more cultures, more rituals, more dresses, more smells, more foods, more habits than any other part of the world. Then, if we get 75 to 90% right, it's a big achievement.
Secularism is not at all related with religion. even in Oxford Dictionary, you can see that there is no relation between secularism and religion. That is why the constitution draft is did not mentioned in the constitution. But let
Bedekar said, it is so obvious that secularism is one of our pillars. We don't need to specify it. So secularism is very much a basic pillar of our constitutional scheme. But ultimately, it was brought in by Mrs. Indira Gandhi. And let me tell you, today, the kind of threats we see to secularism, I think it's a jolly good idea to have the word in the constitution.
Yani ucha samayathe oru deerghamaya prasangam allengil idivare ketra ningal endekilum paranju mushippikkan njan aagrahikkunnilla bahumanapetta nammude vishishta adithi Abhishek Singh advocate-inum adodoppum thanne Venkatesh Nayakinum Indian Lawyers Congress-inte perile njan nanni rekhapeduthikondu koodathe ivide vannittulla ella anju illagalilum ivide ettittulla ജില്ലാ പ്രസിഡന്റുമാര് അവരുടെ അശ്രാന്തമായ പരിശ്രമത്തിൻ്റെ ഫലമായിട്ടാണ് ഇത്തരത്തിൽ ഒരു 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 സംരംഭം വിജയിച്ചെടുപ്പിക്കാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടുള്ളത്. അതിന് എല്ലാ ജില്ലാ പ്രസിഡന്റുമാരെയും ഞാൻ അഭിനന്ദിക്കുന്നതോടൊപ്പം തന്നെ ഇന്ത്യൻ ലോയേഴ്സിൻ്റെ കോൺഗ്രസിൻ്റെ പേരിൽ അവർക്ക് നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുകയാണ്.